The hydroxyl OH of an alcohol is converted into a good leaving group in the presence of a refluxing acid. And so if that acid has a good nucleophilic counterion, we are going to prefer or enhance substitution reactions. And so for our acids that we have here, HX, the nucleophilic counterions that we'd like to have are chlorine, chloride, bromide, and iodide. So hydrochloric, hydrobromic, and hydroiodic acid are going to work very well. The first case here, we see that it works via an SN2 type mechanism with primary alcohols. It's going to work in a SN2 like mechanism for secondary, although that's up for debate, so we'll talk about that a little bit. And for tertiary alcohols, we're going to proceed via an SN1 mechanism. In general, we're going from an alcohol to an alkyl halide, and our reagents are acid and heat. We've got to reflux this thing. One quick note that if we do use hydrochloric acid, it's weakly nucleophilic in a protic solvent, so we're going to need to use a zinc 2 chloride catalyst to enhance the reaction for substitution SN2 type conditions, primary and secondary alcohols, when we're using HCl. Okay, and these are all alkyl groups on the alcohols with no acidic sensitive interfering functional groups. So let's have a look at why we're using acid to enhance this reaction. And so let's take first a look here at our starting materials. So if we took just a generic alcohol without acidifying and we tried to react it with a nucleophile halogen, we would start lower in energy, but we can raise the energy of our reactants a little bit by protonating that alcohol. Okay, let's see what that has to do with what we're looking at. So in the presence of a protic ionizing solvent, this is for tertiary alcohols that we're looking at the SN1 mechanism here and how protonation affects our reaction pathway. What it's going to do is it's going to lower the transition state as well as raise the reactant. So the net of what we've done here is we've reduced the energy of activation of this pathway considerably by the protonation step. We can additionally get over that hill by cranking up the heat and increasing the temperature by the Arrhenius equation. That increases the fraction of particles that have the energy to get over this activation barrier. And so we have a couple things working for us. We also lower the energy of the intermediates because we don't have two opposing charges here, a plus and a minus, a tertiary carbocation with water and a nucleophilic halide. There are only two things with charges at the intermediate step versus three things with charge there. So we do lower that as well. And we also lower the energy of the products overall because we don't have a charge in the final product mixture, increasing the delta G, the overall equilibrium of reaction here, which is negative RT natural log of the equilibrium constant. So we make it a more favorable equilibrium constant as well, more likely to go toward products, because exchanging a halide for a very unhappy negatively charged oxygen is probably not a good thing thermodynamically as well. So it helps us out big time to add that acid and then push it along with some reflux. So let's look at our different scenarios here. So if we are a primary alcohol, we want to protonate and then perform an SN2 substitution. And so we'll do that here with zinc chloride, just as an example, to activate our alcohol even more. We're going to show this substitution reaction occurring. Now we've got a good leaving group, even better than H2O plus there. And so that's a zinc chloride. There's still a proton on this oxygen, so it's got a plus charge. So that's a Lewis acid. Rather than a proton donor and a Bronsted acid, we've got an electron acceptor here, the zinc Lewis acid, zinc 2 chloride there. Now we've got the good leaving group, and what do we say do? Protonate and then perform the SN2. And so if we have our nucleophile generated here in the chloride, we can then attack back, and we've got a good enough leaving group now to get that off, and we get our substitution reaction. Okay, For a secondary alcohol, here's where the controversy comes in. Suppose we have a secondary alcohol reacted with our mineral acid and reflux. What are we going to get? Well, if it's a chiral center, and say we did have chirality here at this chiral center, we would scramble the chirality, get both R and S for our substitution product and our alkyl halide. So we can write that down, take it to the bank. In the old way of thinking, this occurs through an SN1 mechanism. So we'll look at both ways, and then you can decide which way you'd like to show it on my exam or what you believe. I'd encourage you to do some more reading out there for substitution at secondary carbons, SN1 or SN2. And so what we would traditionally show is protonation, just like we said before, to catalyze the reaction. And then we'd say, well, the secondary carbon, we'd have a SN1 type leaving of the leaving group to form the secondary carbocation, and then we'd have the iodine counter ion, or whichever mineral acid we're dealing with, come back in and add to that position. It can add from the top or bottom because we're planar in sp2 with that carbocation, so we get both R and S. If we go by the latest interpretation, we get started the exact same way. We protonate to activate the leaving group. And then we're still with our chirality here retained, but now we would say this occurs via an SN2 because the secondary carbocation is too unstable to form. What would happen, backside attack, inversion of stereochemistry, is initially we would have this in the first inversion, okay? And the reason we see inverted stereochemistry is because of the equilibrium that forms in the hot thermodynamic type conditions where another water molecule could attack and displace the original protonated alcohol. And so that would invert the stereochemistry. And if that were to react with an iodide molecule, then we would get the inverted product. It's also possible in these harsh conditions for an iodine itself to displace another iodine in an SN2 fashion, and that would explain why we see both the R and S enantiomers, even though SN2 is really in play to avoid the unstable secondary carbocation. So whichever way you want to show it on our exam will work. However, the most recent thinking leans toward this explanation. Contact ion pairs is another search term you could look up to get more information on this. If it's a tertiary alcohol, we're definitely going to protonate and then perform an SN1. Here's the protonation step yet again. Won't show the arrows for that. We're pretty good at that by now. But it definitely undergoes, that's just acid-base reaction, undergoes SN1 elimination there. Of the leaving group, and then substitution to complete the SN1 of our bromide, in this case, can add from the top or bottom. It's not a chiral center, but if it were, we'd get R and S at that position. A couple notes to remember about this process. In acid, the reaction rates, the substitution rates, tertiary is going to be faster than secondary, is going to be faster than primary because of the poor nucleophile ability. The leaving group has to start leaving before the nucleophile can get there, even if we're on a primary carbon. So a pretty big delta plus has to form there before the nucleophile can add, and that's pretty unstable for a primary carbon. It slows it down from a normal, we'd consider SN2 to be faster. And so in that order. The other factor is the nucleophile ability of the halide in a protic solvent. Iodides better than bromide is better than chloride because of polarizability considerations. We'll be faster for iodide and slower for chloride. We even need a catalyst for chloride. Consequences of our equilibrium conditions, the reversibility of that SN2 inversion that we saw from above. Okay, just another way of thinking about how that inversion may occur through a sequential SN2 reactions. When we have equilibrium conditions, barriers don't mean very much in a reaction pathway, so we can hop those barriers and get into different energy wells that are similar in energy. The potential rearrangements of these secondary systems are explained and by the old way of thinking, the traditional way of thinking, as just a carbocation-induced shift, where we might have an SN1 pathway first to form the secondary carbocation that then performs a hydride shift to form the tertiary, more stable carbocation, as we've seen in the previous video for carbocation rearrangements. If we're thinking of the new way of thinking, where the secondary carbocation is too unstable to form, we would explain this phenomenon via anchimeric or neighboring group assistance, where the slide over pushes the leaving group the rest of the way off. So we get a neighboring group participation, we go directly to the tertiary cation, which is more stable, and then we add our nucleophile in the end.